Thanks for coming out. I've been preparing some observations. I think most of you know me. My name is Victor. I've been teaching music here at Thatcher for about 8 years. Before that time, I was a full-time musician at the Blue Man Groove Show in Boston for 14 years. I still work there part-time. Throughout all of that time, I've also taught grown-ups, particularly in large groups. And this talk is a bit of a response to some of the articles and publications that have been coming out about music and how cool it is to learn music. But wanting really to get a little bit more at stuff that I've found very practical, that has really succeeded in learning music. And in reflecting about this, I've really come to see that there's a dimension of work that exists between the theory of music and the stuff you practice as a musician. And interestingly, this is also very in line with a lot of the work we do here in the Montessori approach to teaching. So I wanted to present it to the community and the world. That's a bit about me. I just want to ask real quick out there. I see some parents, I see some students. How many of you identify as being a musician? Okay, cool. All right. The talk tonight's kind of in three sections. We're going to take a little bit of a look at some of the sensorial aspects of learning music, and coincidentally, this is what we really focus on in the early years of education, between 2.5 and 5 or 6. This is to really build coordination among particular senses. And interestingly, in that age, the brain is really hungering for this coordination. And if you give experience at that time, every human being has what it takes to become a musician, to be able to have even perfect pitch, to differentiate an octave into 7 different tones and subdivide it even further, or to feel a beat and subdivide the beat. Every human being can do that if they have this coordination in those early years. The second part of the talk is going to zoom way out a little bit into the cosmic level of music and its relationship to creativity. This is going to lead us back down into the individual and what some of the more detailed aspects of the individual as that progression through life takes hold. And this is a very useful thing in my view, because it can really let you know if you're a practicing musician what your next work is, or if you're teaching, how to observe to give the next level of exercise and to make it a meaningful process. Okay? I made some slides. These are some of the vocabulary words. There'll be a little test at the end. These are some of the main terms we'll be looking at. Before we get to those, I'm going to just ask you guys to do a few things rather than just talk at you. These are a few exercises that I actually do with all my students, regardless of their age. At every age, this work always. And I can even say from experience watching some of the very accomplished musicians I work with at Blue Man, it's not just a Victor thing. This is something accomplished musicians do. So I'm going to ask you to do a few things. The first thing I'm going to ask you to do is simply to close your eyes. And I would like you to use your hearing. And I'd like you to listen outside of this space in all directions. And really simply to hear. And if you hear sounds, don't name them, just stay with the hearing. And now, let that go and bring your hearing into the boundary of this room that we share. And only the sounds in this room. And interestingly, hearing can really give us a sense of the space of the room. It's possible even to know where the ceiling is. And then let that go and bring your hearing only to your personal space, the little bubble around you that has your energy, or you could reach out and touch with your fingertips. And then lastly, bring your hearing to what's within you. Hear the space inside you. And sometimes, if you need a little way to focus that, perhaps imagine the sound of someone who loves you saying your name. Now, these are four boundaries of space. And our hearing can connect us to all of them. And one of the interesting things about hearing is that it does that in a continuous line. There really isn't separation from the inner hearing and the outer hearing. In some ways, it's a unique sense in that regard. It's also very powerful. Sounds from very far away can be heard. Wonderful. I'm going to ask you guys, we could go to therapy for this, but I'm just going to do it the magical way. Whoosh. You guys have all been magically dispelled of any inhibitions that you have. And you are now as you were when you were about 2.5 years old, and no one has ever told you to be self-conscious. Nor have you ever told yourself to be self-conscious. And wonderfully, you can just follow the lead to do anything. Because why not? Who knows? Great. So we're just going to do a little exercise. I want you to hear the sound I make and then to try and make that sound together. Take your fingers and just this is nice. Feels good. Do. Thank you. Say, do this for me. Hey!
Hey!
Yeah!
Yeah!
Oh, I feel great!
Oh, I feel great!
It's been raining for 2 days!
It's been raining for 2 days!
I love the dark, cold weather!
I love the dark, cold weather!
I hope it rains for another month!
I hope it rains for another month!
Oh, that's good. Can you go? Do, 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 do. Oh, you guys are cute. Okay. Well, that's nice. Okay, dandy slide. So, in a quick survey, what we've just taken a look at are really three senses, and I just want to put it on your map because music work does very much center around being able to experience these senses. The auditory sense, I already talked about it a little bit. Hearing is not something that necessarily just happens. When I asked you to listen outside the room, perhaps some of you heard the traffic. Well, that traffic has been going on all the time. It didn't just start. But we have to hear. And music refines our hearing and refines our hearing. But it does it in this very interesting way because it's not just hearing. Music also involves a sense of rhythm. To experience rhythm, you have to have a coordinated sense of these two other senses, the vestibular sense and the proprioceptive sense. And the vestibular sense is located in the inner ears, and it's what gives us our sense of balance and uprightness. And the vestibular sense and the proprioceptive sense, both of these senses have really been declared to be the sixth and seventh senses of our sensory abilities. In fact, they've mapped them out, and they have their own little space in the brain, just like the other senses. The proprioceptive sense is connected to your body awareness through the extensor system. It's the way that you know where your little finger is without having to look at it. If I ask you to imagine raising your hand, you imagine something. This is your imaging this sensory system. Now raise your hand. Yeah. Then you know where your hand is. This is different than touch. I do not for the life of me know why they chose a four-syllable and a five-syllable word for something that should be being taught to three-year-olds. Because, actually, interestingly, there's this thing which they're finding in education, which is very important, about sensory coordination. And central to sensory coordination are the four-syllable and the five-syllable senses. These senses give you your sense of rhythm because to measure time always requires some kind of cyclical pendulum. We have the orbit of the Earth and the orbit of the moon for the month and the day of the rotation and the breath. But to have a musical sense, you have to feel the registration of something in the field of your body. Where do you, what is that field? Well, it's these two senses, your balance and your weight in space. Interestingly, people who listen to music, even if you're sitting still, have a very physical impact. Music weaves these senses together. So sound becomes weight. And through dance, weight becomes sound. Also, very significantly, these three senses of those seven senses are the self-locating senses. Sight is out, smell is out, touch, I reach out, taste. I don't know. Okay. So that's a little bit about it's the work for all musicians daily, but very important for children. I'm going to zoom out now. This is the big moment here. I want to talk a little bit about these three terms. This is really looking at the relationship of the individual to the great force of life. I need to speak a bit about something which is very tricky to put into words. And part of the reason is that language is very linear, and the thing I need to talk about is not. And that's this notion of creativity, the non-linear nature of creativity. And the reason is that there's this part of the individual which can only be understood if you understand that. So we have this word creativity. Now, creativity can be simply defined as the transformation of a system which is at one level of order into a higher level of order. We have moved up. We invent cars. We drive around for years without windshield wipers, and then finally someone sees the future. And you know, it's a lot easier to drive in the rain. Which is good, because you can come to the talk if it's raining. And technology is actually full of these kinds of moments. And so is art and music in particular. We're all living in a particular state in society, and someone who creates, a creative musician who writes music, is able to connect to the moment and put that moment in a particular light. That music goes out into the world, and it changes the world. You cannot unhear what that person taught you about life anymore. And I want to speak a little bit about that gesture, because it's relevant a little bit to what's happening at the school. We're about to present this concert, which was grew out of Bob Dylan's work and this funny event that he got awarded the Nobel Prize. And, one of the things that was very interesting was that in looking at his early work, it's very easy to see that one of the reasons it was so powerful was that not only did he really struggle to look inside himself and just understand his own self, but he went out and really tried to see how did people live? What were people going through? The people on the street, you know, the people in the farmlands, the people everywhere. And so he was both reaching in and reaching out. And this gesture of reaching out, we call valor, is to try and see what you need and then, you know, what's going to help us? Oh, you're thirsty? Let me get you some water. Oh, the system is now in a state of higher order. How do we bring that? Again, this is very important in our school. Another aspect of creativity, though, is that this new order of that's at a higher level, it doesn't just come from putting together the old bits in a new way. It's actually as though something completely new has to come into it. And we see this in the school concert where we try and like get all ready and we're all working on our parts and the whole thing. And we don't actually know what's going to happen. We don't get the certainty that if we do this, then we are sure this will happen. It's too complicated and it's too big for that. In fact, one of the guarantees is that it won't be what we expect it to be. We will actually probably have a moment where we'll look kind of ridiculous. Or we might be embarrassed. Or we'll lose what we thought we might get. But something comes in from somewhere and also makes it more than we could have imagined. The wholeness of the event is bigger than all the little bits that we put together. Where does that come from? It doesn't come from us. Something has to come from somewhere. Now, there's various theories on this. You know, one that I have experienced is that the event takes on a life of its own. And it's almost as though from the future, it is reaching into the past, or into the present, into its past, and organizing it. And I've seen this because many strange things fall into place, besides the stuff that falls apart. And those things that fall into place make the event that thing that changes people's lives. You see this with children when they go through these touch point moments. It's as though their future arrives into them at different stages, and all of a sudden, whoa, they are who they are becoming. It's very peculiar. It's a very strange thing. It's a very strange part of life. Now, the reason I put it up there, and you know, this coming together, I use this word manifestation. We don't actually like make it happen. It's not we plant something and then it grows. It's a lot comes, something comes, possibly from the future. But what's this word will? We have to be able to drive it and accept our loss, knowing that we're participating. Part of it is opening a space for something to happen. Now, in the school and at the individual level, we have very simple the idea and the action. And this could be more than an intellectual. I have to give a speech. I know the idea of the speech. I know how to do a speech. But somewhere between those two things is the I must find my way to the creativity of the speech. And this is the will. Even on a small scale, there is a table and I'm a little kid and I must learn to wash the table. You know, it's a big deal. It's a new level of order for some kids to be able to wash a table. For the musician, we have the theory and we have the technical practices, but these things have to come together. So again, you find that will, but again, just to be clear, this is much easier, more easily seen in the context of life, working to move to a higher level of order. In fact, if you don't connect it there, it can be a little caught in a circle. One of the reasons here, I'm always saying, no, you gotta perform. to the manifestation. Now, finishing up just a little bit with the will. One of the ways that we can measure our own will is the question of directed attention. You've been doing a wonderful job, audience, directing your attention at my talk. I know it's not easy. There will be some cookies afterwards. But to direct your attention past a certain point is an act of will. You can measure this, actually. And a good teacher, in my opinion, is aware of this observation, whether this is a good teacher of yourself or a good teacher of students. How long can attention be sustained? Oh, in fact, let's do this, because you guys need a little something. Who are the musicians? Raise your hand. Okay. And who are the non-musicians? Okay, great. Well, that's a few too many. Let's see. Are you all musicians? Did you all raise your hand?
Can I be a former musician?
I could be a non-musician if you wanted to be one.
Oh, good. Okay.
I could be a non-musician.
Okay.
Okay.
So let's have you three. You come over here, Leo, you'll help them. That'll be good. Okay. Now, this will help to understand what it is I'm talking about. I think you guys are all musicians enough. You guys, I want you to do this. Actually, let's all do this. We're going to clap our hands in a count of five, and we're going to clap on the one and the four. And we're going to do this four times. And then clap on the on a downbeat the last time. And you're all like, what's he talking about? musicians, if you caught what I said, please help the ones that don't understand. Okay, are you ready? So we're going to clap on the one and the four. It'll be something like one, two, three, four, five, one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four, five, one, two, three. And then we stop, because that was four times. In fact, we can make it easy. This is a musician's trick. Change the number of each bar, so we'll count the big bar number. I know it's like, what are you talking about? All right, are you ready? Okay. Count of four. One, two, three. One, two, three, four, five. Two, two, three, four, five. Three, two, three, four, five. Four, two, three. One. That was four bars of five. Awesome, you guys are awesome musicians. Cool. Okay, let's see. Let's try this. You guys are going to then clap five bars of seven. And you're going to clap on the one, four, and six. It'll sound like this. Are you ready? Try it with me if you want to just leave it. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Two, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Three, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Four, two, three, four, five, six, seven. That was pretty easy, right? You guys, remember how you counted four bars of five?
Yeah.
Well, after we do the four together, you're going to do seven bars of five. Yeah? Okay. All right. Julie, why don't you come up front so that in case they get lost, you can show them where they go. Okay. Are you ready? So we'll do four bars of five together, and then we'll switch. I'll help these guys. Julia and Leo can help over here. Okay? Ready? So four together, do seven of five, we'll do five seven. One, two, three. One, two, three, four, five. Two, two, three. Three, four, five. Ready? You guys will have to help them. You ready? Let's see. I'm ready. You ready?
Yep.
One, two, three. That was good. Awesome. Bravo. One comes to see a little bit the work of directing attention. There are, besides the duration of how long can I keep this count to seven going, Victor, before I zone out, the frequency, how quickly, if you lose your directed attention, do you come back to it? Oh, it's the end of the day, and boy, I'm running on fumes. And then a third way, too, is how many aspects of your functioning are you able to pay attention to while you're directing your attention? For instance, if that were part of a musical piece and it were part of a narrative thing where you had to keep track of the form of a song, and then perhaps it was telling a story, and so it wasn't only just that you had to switch parts, but each part had to have emotional quality to it. These would be all things that would be part of your fluid directed attention, and are all things that are cultivated in the practice of musicianship in service to creativity. I made a little list of some of the things that I work with my students. These are a little bit divided up for convenience into intellectual and emotional and sensory motor levels. But these are all things which you can direct your attention more or less towards while you play music. And all of which become more coordinated with each other. I thought I might ask Julia to play a piece for us, and she very generously said that she would struggle through something. We don't even know if any of this works. Thank you. questions? Yes.
So how do you respond when kids say, I'm not creative, I'm not musical, I can't sing, or how do you address that as a music teacher when they've got these limiting beliefs?
Most of the time, oh, I have to answer. Most of the time, there was a man who used to come here, his name was Alon Seacroft, a really high, world-class piano player, used to give lessons. And a kid said that to him, and he said, I was there in the room, and he looked at the kid and astonished me. He said, who taught you that? it was so beautiful, because he wasn't joking. He was with the soul of the kid, like, don't let someone put that on you. That's sort of the sword cut through it approach. It's a struggle. We all have it. All artists struggle with it. There's a funny thing which is important to learn, though, which goes back to this notion of what creativity is, which is that, honestly, it isn't you. We are mostly dumpy, frumpy beings. But we have access if we take ourselves seriously about it. And that, again, though, this is what I'm personally trying to demonstrate. Because you have to live that. I could never quite just convince you. You have to have had that experience many times, and I feel very privileged to be here where the kids are blessed to have this experience repeatedly. Because actually, they're pretty convinced. You know, yeah, let's just go do it. I don't know. It's going to be embarrassing and humiliating, but let's go do it. Why? Because we're changing the world. Julia, would you come sing? How old are you?
13.
How many 13-year-olds do you know? And there's two here in the room. They would just get up and sing in front of people if you just asked them on the spot. You know, why? Well, I don't know. Because something might happen. Is it hard? Is it awkward? Is it... Yeah, because the stuff I know that's going to happen, I'm not real happy about. It's always that way. So I don't know if that quite answers it, but you know, there's a little, there's a characteristic on that. Any other questions? Okay to stop and have cookies. I'm a little curious, like, for the students, if what I said made some sense in general. Yeah?
I'd be interested, Victor, just a little bit more on you know, you talked here about the music as a sort of an experience, and I think the voice is part of it, and the ability to hold a rhythm and become, you know, in tune with a rhythm or timing with a rhythm,
mm-hmm.
and maybe if you could speak a little bit about that in terms of how you lay a foundation for it being possible for someone like Julie to get up and just do that.
Yeah. Well, I have this handy chart here.
Yeah.
So the things that you speak to really are sensory motor, the sensory motor level. We have to really become coordinated at that place. And the voice, very connected to the hearing. You know, it's really our line out of the same axis. A lot of the work begins there. And it's very important for musicians in general. The drummers who get the gig at Blue Man, and believe me, I've sat through an audition of 75 drummers and not hired one of them, not a single one out of 75 in the city of Boston, the musician in town. The drummers who get the gig at Blue Man, they can vocalize what they play. Or if you vocalize a part to them, they can transform it into a drummer. It's interesting. So we have these issues of, am I dexterous in my motor functioning? Am I able to hear my surrounding while I hear my own voice? Is that a coordinated experience? Can I coordinate my sense of the rhythm? Everyone else is dancing twice as fast as me. Why am I moving this fast? Wait a minute, this is not, it's different. How do you adjust? So that's foundational. And again, ideally this is food given to the developing brain between the ages of about 2.5 and 6, I'd say. You know, growing up from there, we begin to awaken a sense of the story. I had a beautiful experience. We're teaching the kids this song. If Julia didn't sing tonight, I was going to sing one of the songs the kids are learning. It's called When the Ship Comes In. It's by Bob Dylan. It's a, you know, it's an awesome song. It's this totally heroic, epic, you know, 32 lines of amazing rhyme scheme about this ship just arriving with the good guys that defeats the bad guys. That's all it is, but it's 32 lines. The verse is amazing. Nothing repeats. And I was walking out, and there were like 8 kids in the lobby, and they were singing the song. These are like 7-year-olds, and they're all out there, and they're just doing it. You know, and it's totally, it was amazing. And this is narrative. Yeah. And, you know, the notion of identity. You know, we're the good guys. And it's also that awakening of form. They couldn't just do that. We had to sit down and do a lot of exercises to figure out, how do I know that the song will lift when the mainsail shifts as the beginning of the 5th verse and not the 3rd verse? And, you know, we've spent a long time really trying to think about what do you need to do to think this is the structure of a narrative moment in sequence. And yet all of that is coordinated with the hearing and the rhythm, and I can hear my friends, I can sing on pitch with them, you know, and this is where it gets exciting, so I sing louder. And so these things are really experiential to me. And yet, interestingly, I mean, when you think you're going to go study music, this is really not generally so much on the map. But these are the things you have to pay attention to. Ask Julia, I mean, you know, there's several young musicians here, Sandra. The kids here, they understand narrative. It scares me sometimes. then my experience listening to some of these musicians in the room is that they, when they're singing that first or second verse, they know where they're going to be, like that last line. It's intense. It's 13-year-olds. So, does that help?